RVFN. Okay, it is a fit forward neural network, so there is no, backpropagations algorithm that you are going to use, and it is very fast neural network. So people are using because it has got only one single hidden layer. Okay, so you cannot have more than one hidden layer. So that is why it is a very good. Time is less to train. Okay. And so these networks are it is commonly used type of artificial neural network. Function approximation problems. So it's actually used for the function approximation problems. And this RVFN is neural basis function network are distinguished. You can distinguish from other neural networks due to their universal approximation ability and the faster learning speed. So that is the main thing. So why faster learning speed? Because you have only one input layer and one hidden layer and this output layer. Okay. So now these functions has three layers architectures. Input layer. That is, the input layer is made up of source of nodes that connect the network to its environment. The inputs that you are going to have, you have to feeding the input in the forward direction. So that is why it is a fit forward network. Okay, fit forward radial basis function network. So what is the radial basis? So now radial basis means function means it is a nonlinear function is there. So the function is called the radial function. So radial function that here we are considering as a Gaussian function. Okay, here considering as a Gaussian function. So that is why in the hidden layer a nonlinear transformation is applied from the input space. The input data that you are having, you have to transform it by applying some. Suppose X is an input, then you have to do some transformation of the input. Then you will have the phi of x. So phi of x, it is a function. The phi, it is a function of x. Okay, and this phi x is a transformation function, or you can say a non-linear transformation function. That is a radial basis function. Okay, that is transformed from input space to hidden space. And in the output layer, it is a linear, because whenever you have this non-linear classifications problem, then you can apply this radial basis function network. Okay, then we'll see one example, the XOR gate. It is not a linear, so you cannot have one single straight line to separate between these two classes. Then you need to have a non-linear decision boundary, curve type of things. So if you just make a one curve, so now this is a curve linear kind of things that you can have a decision boundary. So in the output layer, it is a linear and it supplies the response of the network to the activation pattern applied to the input layer. In the output layer, you have in the RVM network, the output of a node, of any particular node, suppose in the output layer, you have the K node. Now the output of the node K of the output layer of this network, you can calculate it by using this same formula. Suppose if y is an output in the output layer, and if you are going to find out this k neurons output, then yk is equal to summation of j is equal to 1 to n wjk into phi j. So here the weights will be associated from the hidden layer to output layer. So now some weight matrix will be there, then weight will be multiplied with this this transformation function or this radial basis function. So that is a phi jx. So jth neuron is a hidden neurons. So now this wjk into phi of jx, summation of I is equal to 1 to n. So this is your y. So this is an output. So now whenever you're going to train the model, that is, you can have this radial basis function. If you are going to train the RVM model, so when you are going to terminate? So now this model, when the training will be completed? You can say in this way, the training of this RVM model is terminated once the calculated error, the error has to be calculated. The error means this is a mean square error. Okay, the calculated error, it reach to the desired values. Okay, suppose if you are putting this calculated value error, this you are assuming 0.01. Okay, now if the mean square error are reaching to this thing, then the trading is completed. Okay, or the number of trading iteration, let's say 500 iteration that you have used or you have exhausted, then after 500 iteration also is completed, then also the trading will be completed. So now this RBF network, it requires less time. So what is the difference between the RBF parallel basis function network and the multi-layer perceptron network? Because NLP will take large time, okay, to converge, okay, but here this RBF, it requires less time to reach the end of the training as compared to the NLP. So that is why it is a very wonderful networks that people are using, very fast. So due to is only one hidden layer, and it's computationally it is very easy. It's not too heavy that you could get the result in a very faster manner. So now these radial basis functions, as you have, is only one hidden layer, and the convergence is much faster because that you have only one hidden layer, and it is used as a, I already told you, it is this RBF network can be distinguished from other neural networks due to its universal approximations ability and this faster learning speed. Okay. Next is that your RBF networks have many applications. As you can see, you can apply like function approximations, then you can apply it in some interpolations method, you can apply in classifications for the time series data predictions, means weather forecasting, okay, and these applications it can serve in various industrial interests like stock price predictions, anomaly detections, okay, in data, fraud detection in financial transactions. So these are the possible applications that people are looking for the possible solutions after applying the radial basis function. Okay, and so this network is a type of the artificial neural network with an input layer, one hidden layer, and one output layer. And this hidden layer, it consists of hidden neurons. Okay, and one activation function is there for these hidden neurons. So that is a Gaussian function, because it's a single variant Gaussian function that you have to use. Single variant Gaussian function, okay, or you can have this single dimension Gaussian function in this case. And the hidden layer it generates a signal which is corresponding to the input vector in the input layer, and the signal which is being generated by the hidden layer, which is corresponding to the signal, so it generates this output response. Okay, as you can see, so this is a bell shaped curve that you know, all of you, that is that how to generate an output, because each in the hidden layer, so means you have some hidden nodes, or this is called the hidden neurons, and in each hidden neurons can be modeled using the, it is a functional approximation. You can model these hidden neurons by a Gaussian function. So this Gaussian function is called the radial basis, the functions. Okay, so now actually to generate the output, this neuron process, each neuron in the hidden layer, it processes this input signal. So this particular function, so that is why it is called the activation function of the neuron. So it has got different names. One is called activation function, nonlinear transformation function, radial basis functions. Okay. Now the RBF activation functions of hidden neuron is denoted by phi of x, because that you are applying this activation function on the input data. Okay. It means that for an input vector x, the output which is going to produced by the hidden neuron denoted by the phi of x. Now this phi of x, it is a bell-shaped curve, and you have a one center that is mean, and there is a width. This is a phi. So phi is called the width of these things. And this formula is that 5x is equal to e to the power minus x minus mu square divided by sigma square. Okay, so where x is data, input data, and how much dispersion is there from this scale. And this sigma has to be computed based on the value of this sigma. It depends. Okay, now it is a 2 sigma, it is a 3 sigma, it is 1 sigma, and there is a height is there. So there is a 2 important things. One is called this height of the function and the width of the function. Then you need to compute it. So this figure represents the Gaussian activation functions for one dimensional input x. Okay, as you can see, the input only you have only one dimensional input and with center mu. Now this activation function, or you can say the neural activation function, it represents this output of the Gaussian node for a particular given value of x. Okay, so now it can be clearly seen that the signal strength, so the signal that is being received from the input neurons, so now the signal strength, it decreases as the input move away from the center. If the inputs are move away from the center, then the signal strength, it decreases. So now the basic idea of this model is that the entire feature vector space is partitioned entire feature vector space is partitioned by, because if you have x1 to xd, we are at the d dimensional features, partitioned by the Gaussian neural nodes. Okay, and because each node in the hidden layer, it is handled by the hidden neurons, and it is partitioned by the hidden Gaussian neural nodes, where each node generates, because every node generates a signal which is corresponding to an input vector, and the strength of this signal, okay, it is decreases if the input is far from the mean, or if the input is as the input x move away from the center. Now the strength of the signal which is produced by the neuron, it depends on, so that is also important things, that is that it depends on the how much distance that you can calculate it between its center means there is a mean, and the input vector. As you can see, this is x minus mu. So x minus mu is nothing but it is how much distance, means what is the distance, the strength of the signal that can be calculated by each neuron. It depends on the distance between its center and the input vector. And for inputs, so if the inputs lie closer in Euclidean vector space, so actually it is a norm. So now these things is being x minus mu square. You can write it in a Euclidean norm. How much deviation is there from the mean for each input data? So that is being, this is going to computed. Now the inputs lying closer in Euclidean vector space. It is a two-dimensional Euclidean space. Okay, that is then the output signals are generated must be similar. So that is the very important things. Okay, the strength of the signal which is produced by the each neuron, it depends on the distance between the center and the input vector. Okay, and also for input lying closer in Euclidean vector space, the output signal that are generated must be similar. So here mu is the center of the neuron, as you can see. Phi x is the response of the neuron which is corresponding to input x. So now the question comes, why it is called the radial basis function? Okay, it means that the values are the output from the radial basis function, that because the radial basis functions on a two dimensional feature space. So suppose if you just compute it for each value of sigma, then you can get this as a shape of the two dimensional vectors, and the values that is being obtained from this output, these values are equidistant from the center. So if the values are equally situated, so that is for the equidistant from the center in all directions, have the same values. So that is why these are called the relative basis function. So the output signals that are generated must be similar. So that is the thing, because the values equidistant from the center in all directions have the same value. Means whatever directions that you are going to follow, that you will have the, it will produce the same values. So that is why these are called the relative basis function. So as you can see, there's a graph. This figure is there, x1 and x2, and the above figures, that these circles represent the Gaussian neural nodes, because each nodes, because it is in hidden layers, we just considering the hidden layers nodes. Okay, so this circle represent these Gaussian neural nodes, and the boundary of the circle it represent the range of the corresponding nodes. So now the range of the corresponding nodes, so for each boundary, it is called the receptive field of the neurons. Okay, it is called the receptive field of the neuron. Here you can see is a two-dimensional vector space is partitioned by the 12 Gaussian node. Okay, there is a 12 Gaussian node, and every input, that is capital X, X is a vector, and if you consider it as a d-dimensional vector, so every input vector activates the collective system of the neurons, okay, to some extent, and you have you, that is a, the combination of this activation enables the RBM to decide how to respond. So these are the internal structures of the receptive field of the neurons, okay, and these configurations will generate the similar output signals for input vectors A and B. Okay, that is then, because as they are very closer, because the distance, so as they are this equidistant, the values are equidistant from the center, or if you consider for one cell, and if you just put the how many data points are there which is are very equally distant from the center, then in all direction, then you have this the same values. So that is why it is written, it will generate the similar output signal for input vectors A and B, whereas C output will be generated will be quite different. Okay, because if you just consider in this way, so that is why these points which are very closer to each other, then this computed this Euclidean norm, okay, from xi minus mean, so from the mean, that how much deviation is there. So that is the things, and as you can see, as this x1 x2, this, if you consider that it is in this center is this somehow in the origin, okay, and this points A and B are very closer to this to the center, but apart from the other, this C is not it is far apart from this, or far away from the mean, then obviously the output signal will not be similar. So that is the basic concepts. That is why this graph is there. Now in the RBF architecture, the weights are connected, this input vector. So now as you can see, there's an input layer is there, x1, x2, xn, and for the hidden layer, because if you have the kth neuron in the hidden layer, only one hidden layer, and for each hidden neuron is being modeled using this phi. Phi is a relative basis function. So phi1x, phi2x, and you have the phi kx, and you have then the output of the each hidden neuron that will be go to your is output layer, and it will that is a c1x. So now phi1x into c1x, it is an output. Okay, or you can have the ckx, or simply the ckx will be that is simply what if you just make a loop, j is equal to 1 to n, wjk into ck or cjx, that you can have. It means that in the output RBF architecture, the weights are important here. Okay, so weights connecting input vector to the hidden neurons, okay, it represent the center of the corresponding neuron. Now the weights are predetermined in such a way that the entire space is covered by the receptive field of these neurons, whereas the values of weights connecting hidden neurons to output neurons determined to getting it. Yes. So what you have to do? There is a whenever you are going to apply RBFN, then these two processes that you need to follow. First of all, in the first stage, you have to compute, you have to determine the center and width are determined, okay, using some unsupervised technique. Because each phi, if phi is a nonlinear function, then it is, we are considering it is a Gaussian function, or in the Gaussian function, you have a center and the width. Now, these two parameters has to be computed using this some unsupervised technique. So now unsupervised technique is called the clustering method. So using the clustering method, you have to compute the center and width that must be determined using the clustering method. In the second step, the connection width, okay, in the second stage, the connection width between the hidden layer and the output layer are found. Okay, in the second stage, the connection width, okay, connection width means W. This is a weight matrix. So connection width means there is a W. In the second stage, you have to compute or you have to find what are the connection width between the hidden layer and the output layer. That need to be found in a way such as an error criteria. I mean, you have to find this weight in such a way so that you have to put an error criterion functions like the common mean squared error is minimized over all the data sets. So that is the thing. So now three things you have to compute. So whenever you are going to apply this real basis function, the three parameters you need to compute. One is called the centers and width that has to be determined using the clustering method. Another is that you have to compute this is a connection width, means weight matrix between the hidden layer and the output layer. Okay, and this matrix has to be found in such a way that's error criterion like this common mean squared error MSE is minimized over the data sets. Okay, so now it is appropriate if vector lying close to the Euclidean space falls under the receptive cell of the same neuron. So therefore the centers of the hidden, so that is to be determined, as I already told you, the center and the width. The center of the hidden neurons are determined using the k-means clustering algorithm. So k-means clustering algorithm, so I'll discuss probably in the next class or next to next class. So this is the method. Okay, the center of the hidden neurons that has to be determined using the k-means clustering. Okay, and this, what is the k-means clustering? So I'm just telling you this in a nutshell. You have to first choose the number of cluster center k, first thing. Then you have to just randomly choose these k points, because your objective is to find the cluster head, final cluster centers. So first, the cluster, this number of cluster centers k, you have to choose how many clusters that you are going to do. K is equal to 3, k is equal to 5, k is equal to 4, k is equal to 6. Then you have to choose the randomly k points, okay, any points from the data sets, and set them as k centroid of the data. If you choose the two points, then that they set them as the k centroid, I mean two centroid of this data. Now for all the points in the data sets, I mean in the input data, you have to determine the centroid closest to it, okay, closest to this k centroid that you have chosen. Then for all the centroid, calculate the average of all the points closest to the same centroid. Okay, so this is called, now whenever you are going to apply the k-means algorithm, here we have to compute, this is a dissimilarity measurement. Okay, so now here also the Euclidean norm that we are going to use. So from the mean, that how much deviation is there from the mean for the data point. So that is the important, that for to finding the center of the hidden layers, that the width, then you have to apply the k-means clustering algorithm. So these are the process. Now you have to change the value of all the centroid to the corresponding averages calculated in form. Now go to step number 3 until it is converged. So whenever I'll explain to you, then you will get to know the more details about this k-means clustering. So it is just for this, the how the k-means clustering works. So it is there, because your objective is to find the centers has to be determined by using the k-means clustering. Now the range of range means width. Okay. Now the range of the receptive cell or the receptive fields. So receptive fields is this. This is a boundary of this. I mean Gaussian neural. Okay. So now the range of the receptive field that can be chosen such that this entire domain of the feature vector is covered by the receptive field of the neural. So now here the width width is very important. Width is called that is how much dispersion is there. I mean how the data are far away from the mean. So now so that is why the value is called the sigma. So sigma is chosen according to the maximum distance d between two hidden neurons. So that is the thing. Now where so this formula you have to apply to compute this sigma. The width you have to compute this center. You have to compute this width. Now what is the formula of the width? That this is sigma is equal to d by square root of 2m. So where d is the maximum distance between two hidden neurons and m is the number of hidden neurons. So this, by these things you can compute this sigma. Now what are the mathematical development of this thing? Suppose, as I already told you, so so you have to compute this is a w. So this is the first thing, that in the first stage aapko kya karna hai, you have to compute the centers and width, and in the second step you have to compute the connection width. So width also, or you can say there's a what are the weight matrix that you need to also compute. So now how do you compute this is a weight matrix? Let Gij be an element of matrix G. Okay, so capital G is a weight matrix, and for in the matrix you have some, suppose m cross n element, then for each element being represented by small Gij. Okay, it is an element of G representing the output of jth neuron. So jth neuron is your for this. This is jth neuron for the ith input vector. Okay, this is a jth neuron for your ith input vector, and Wij be an element of matrix W. It represents the weight connecting this ith output neuron to the jth hidden neuron. Okay, so now the weight will be computed connecting to the ith output neuron. Because I is a in the output neuron, in the output layers, so whatever nodes are there, I is equal to 1, 2, 3 till n. Okay, so this is connected to the ith output neuron to the jth hidden neuron. So jth hidden neuron is there just a previous layer. Now in the RBF, the activation function of output neuron is linear. Okay, in the activation function of output neuron, it is a linear. So that is G of J, so that is simply J. Where J is, so what is J? It is an weighted summation. As I already told you, summation of J is equal to 1 to n W J K into phi J X. That is the thing. So now the J is a weighted summation of the signals from hidden layer. Okay. Now you have to multiply the ith row of J, ith row of G with jth column of W, because whenever you are going to apply the matrix multiplication. So first matrix, the row of the first matrix will be the same as the column of the second matrix. So that is why multiplying the ith row of G with the jth column of W. Okay, and so you are going to have, so thus the weighted summation of data, which is equal to this produced by the jth output neuron. So now that is the thing. GW is equal to T. Okay, where T is the column vector, and the ith row contains the targeted value. Okay, or the actual desired output of the ith training vector. Now you have to apply whenever you are going to compute W. So W you have to measure. So you are going to have the three parameters. One is called the center. You have to use compute. Center is k-means clustering. Sigma with sigma formula is given. Next is your W. So W formula is given. So by from the above equation, by the method, you have to apply the pseudo inverse. So that is a W is equal to G transpose G inverse into G transpose T. So everything is given, where G transpose is the transpose of the matrix G. So in this way, you can compute, and your output will be Y. YK will be summation of J is equal to 1 to N WJK into 5JX. Okay, it means the output of the node K of the output layer of this network can be calculated. So these are the three things. Okay, now how to run this? What is the algorithm? Now in a nutshell, these RBF steps. First, you define the number of hidden neurons, that is K. So whatever I taught you, so in a nutshell, that RBF, how to implement RBF. So these are the algorithm that has to be followed. First step, define the number of hidden neurons, that is K. Second step, set the positions of RBF center. ठीक है, you have to compute, this is a mean. Set the position of the RBF center using k-means clustering algorithm. Next, calculate sigma using the equation number 2. Calculate the actions of RBF node using equation number 1. Next, you have to train the output using the equation number 3. So that is equation number 3, that is equation number 2, and that is equation number 1. Okay, so these are the things. So there is a difference of RBF versus MLP that I already told you, that MLPs are advantageous over RBF when there is a underlying characteristic of the feature data is embedded deeply inside very high dimensional data set. Okay. So then this RBF is, the MLP is advantageous. Having this RBF have only one layer, so it is much faster than the MLP. Okay, and its convergence rate is also high. So these are the things. Now we will see there's a another architecture, that is how to practically you can solve this problem. Okay, so now in the RBF you have a set of neurons, then in the hidden layers you have only one hidden layers in the, from the hidden layer to the output layer you have some weight associated. Now YK, suppose if you have kth node in the output layer, then YK you can write J is equal to 1 to N WJK, okay, into 5JX. So one hidden layer with RBF activation function, you have phi 1, phi 2 till phi m 1. And output layer, obviously you will have a linear activation function. So that is a, so that's why you have the linear combination. Y is equal to W into phi. That is the things. So Y is equal to W1 phi 1 into X minus T1. Means X minus T1 means how much deviation is there from the mean. So that is why it is written. Now then WM1 into phi M1 into X minus TM1. But X minus T is the Euclidean norm, or you can say the Euclidean distance of the distance of X from the vector T. So T will be given to you. Okay. So to compute it, we'll see on one example. Okay, before that, you have this input vector and these are the neurons. So where we have to compute, this is a mu 1, mu 2 and mu k. So mu is the prototype to compare against these each neurons in the hidden layer. There's a, I mean, you have the weights is there. Okay, you have a weights for this first. Hidden layer to the output layer. Then you have. Then you have to do this weighted sum. So in the weighted sum, you have a category one. If you have the two class, the if it is if its weighted sum is greater than zero, or if it is a positive, then it is one class. If it is negative, then it is another class. If you are using these two class, if you are solving this two class classification problem, and this weighted sum, if it is positive, then it is a simply y. Then it is one class. If it is negative, then it is another class. So now our weighted sum, then category one score, then category two. Category two means second class. Category three, third class. Category C is Cth class. So these are the process. Now here the mu one, mu two, you have to compute. Okay, I will use this prototype to compare against this RBF neurons. Okay, so now this actually the formula of this new this Gaussian kernel that of the order input is 1 by sigma into root over 2 pi e of minus x minus mu square 2 to sigma square. But we are not considering this is this part. So why? That I'll explain. Each RVM neuron, it computes a measure to the similarity between the input and the prototyping vector. So this prototyping vector is taken from the training set. So here you can have this x minus t. So there's a t means is a mean. So it will be given to you. If it is not given to you, then you have to apply the k-means algorithm to find out. Okay. Now there is an x minus mu. And these are different possible choices of similar function, but we can use the most popular, the Gaussian function 1 by sigma root over 2 pi e to the power minus x minus mu square by 2 to sigma square. That where people are using this formula. And where x is an input and mu is the mean and sigma is the standard deviation. And it produces the familiar bell-shaped curve, okay, which is centered at mean. Mu in the plot the mean is 5 and your sigma is your 1, as you can see. So now the RBF activation function. So now in the RBF activation function is slightly different, and it is typically written by e to the power minus beta. Now what is beta that you need to know? Now in the first change that you have to remove the outer coefficients. So what is outer coefficients? 1 by sigma root over of 2 pi. Okay, I mean square root of 2 pi. So this term actually controls, you need to know actually, this term controls the height of the Gaussian. Okay, now the height of the Gaussian will be controlled by this outer coefficients. But sometimes, so though it is a redundant with the weights applied by the output load, because if you use this this term along with the weights, now the both things will be redundant, because it is also weights is also just controlling this is an height of the Gaussian. So that is why, so it is a redundant information. So that is why we are neglecting it. So though it is a redundant with the weights which are applied by the output nodes. So the during training, so the output nodes will learn the correct coefficients or weight to apply to the neural response. So that is why we are neglecting it. In the second stage, so is that we have replaced the inner coefficients. So what is inner coefficients? 1 by 2 sigma square, 1 by 2 sigma square. This is an inner coefficient. So we have replaced the inner coefficients by a single parameter beta. Now this beta, it coefficient, it controls the width of the bell curve. So one controls the height, another controls the width. So height portion that we have removed, because these are the similar to these weights, because these weights are being applied by the output nodes. So that is why we are just neglecting it. And the beta coefficient, it controls the width of the bell curve. So again, in this context, we do not care about the value of sigma. Okay, yeah. So you'll have to just take care that there is some coefficient which is controlling the width of the bell curve. Now, what is the equation? So these are the equation. So RBA neural activation for different values of beta. Now, if beta is equal to 0.5, now the curve will be, in a different color. This shape is given to you. If beta is equal to 2, then the curve is, shape of the curve is different. If beta is equal to 1, the shape of the curve is different. So this is the things that is being explained. Now, in the training process, now how do you train the RBFN? Now, the training process for RBFN, it consists of selecting 3 set of parameters. First, the prototypings like mu, first thing, mean centers. Next is the beta coefficients. Now the 1 by 2 sigma star is being replaced by beta. So actually it is a width. Okay. Now the beta coefficients for each of the RBF neurons and the matrix of the output weights. That is the important. So W, how do you compute W? So it is being already explained. Okay, you have to apply the pseudo inverse method to compute it, and the matrix of output weights between the RBF neurons and the output nodes. Okay, the output of the RBF neurons should be multiplied. So the output of the RBF weight is a phi of phi j. It has to be multiplied with the weight matrix. Okay, the output weights. The 3 are the parameters. Now, how do you select the beta values? If you use k-means clustering to select your prototype, so prototyping is your mu, then one simple method for specifying the beta coefficient is to set sigma, which is equal to the average distance. So now, between all points in the cluster and the cluster set. So you have to apply the sigma is equal to, that is a 1 by m, I is equal to 1 by 2m, xi minus mu. And mu is a cluster center that is to be computed by applying this k-means algorithm. But this mu is a cluster center and m is the number of training samples which belongs to this cluster. And xi is the ith training sample in the cluster. Okay. And once we have the sigma value for the cluster, you can compute the beta. So beta is 1 by 2 sigma square. So if you compute the sigma, so this sigma is nothing but if it is not given to you, suppose if it is not given to you, the t is given to you, but t means mu is given to you, then you can compute the sigma in this way. 1 by m is equal to 1 by m xi minus mu. So that is the formula. Okay, that how to set sigma between. Okay, this average distance between all points in the cluster and the cluster center. So these are the process that you could follow to compute it, mu and sigma and beta. And then if you just see it, RBFN as a neural network, the input layer x0, x1, xn, there's n input values. Then the hidden layer, so one is actually it is in bias. It is in bias will be added. Okay, so it is in bias, so that is why it is there. Phi 1x, okay, bias is also added to the in the output one. That is in then phi 1x, then phi 2x, phi kx. Then you have the z1 is an output. You have the z. I mean, this bias is added to each and every nodes of the output because you have the c output one. Per category, and you have the k hidden per prototype. Okay, so then you can accordingly get the output. So now we'll see this problem. Suppose this is an XOR problem, the same problem that we have done using this multilayer perceptron. So we'll see that. X1 and X2, there is two dimensions, 0, 0, this 1, 1. So now this blue, because you cannot have any boundary to separate between these two class. So, but here you can have in the output space, you have 0 and 1, two class. Okay. So now you have to construct an RBA. little pattern classifiers such that 00 and 11 are mapped to 0, because these two data or these two input pattern are belongs to the 0th class, and 10 and 01, these two input pattern are mapped to the 1, because these are belong to class 2. So that is why you need to do it. So now you have to apply the RBA, that is an RBA pattern classifier. So now what you have to do, you have to this T1 and T2 is given, that is a there's a mu, actually these are the mu, okay, and this in the feature space. Now from the input space you have to go to the feature space. Now in the feature space means in each hidden layer. So now what you have to do, you have to transform the phi 1, that is an x minus t 1, that is a is equal to e to the power minus x minus t 1 square, and x minus t 2 square, and that is a 0 0 1 0, that is in one class, like you can see, which is being denoted, and 0 0 1 1, it is in another thing. So it is called the decision boundary. Now this T1 is given, that is 11 and 00, and there is a specification of the hidden functions for the XOR problem. So in input pattern, in first hidden function that you can compute 10.36 and 0.136. So it is simply that is an 10 for this input pattern 11. So you have this for the first one, it is in 1, that is in second hidden function, that is in 0, and then so on you can compute. Now when you are going to map into feature space, that is a is a feature space, you have the two functions phi 1 and phi 2 for class 1, phi 2 for class 2. When mapped into the feature space, then c1 and c2 become a linearly separable. So a linear classifier with phi 1x and phi 2x as inputs, okay, can be used to solve the XOR problem. Okay, so that is the things that very simply, no need to apply do any back propagations method to solve this particular problem, because it is much more faster than this multilayer perceptron algorithm. So simply these things will be given to you, and then you can apply. So these are the ways that you can have. Now this T1 and T2 will be given, then you phi1 and phi2, then x1 x2, then T1 and T2. So T1 and T2, it is just a prototyping for this hidden neuron 1, hidden neuron 2, then this W1 and W2, that you have to compute it with this formula, okay? And then bias is added plus 1, as you are going to have only one output. Now Y will be computed in this way. So Y is simply but a summation of J is equal to 1 to N WJK into phi JX. Now if Y is greater than 0, then plus 1, otherwise it is plus 0. So whenever you are going to compute Y, then you have to add some bias, plus B. So summation of J is equal to 1 to N WJK phi JX plus bias. Okay, then you can find that if Y is greater than 0, then it is one class, Y is less than 0, that is in other class. So if the prototyping or this mu is given to you, then it's fine. If it is not given to you, then you have to compute it using the KMS algorithm. Okay. So now these are the way, this is a generalized random access function network. Actually, if you have this like this, if you have this more than two this hidden layer, I mean the hidden neurons, that is when xi I is equal to 1 to n, it's large, and 1 to 1 corresponds between the training input data and the green function, it produces the regularization network. So this function is given as input layer, then you have the hidden layer. It means that whenever you are going to have the matrix, okay, so now W naught, you have W1 I mean, W naught is equal to B, that is, you know, and then you have the W1, W2, W3, Wj, then Wm1, then how it looks like. So you have to use in this way. Now, that is the input-output transformation. You have to compute it. For example, data points J is given, that is a 1, 2, 3, 4, the input pattern 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, and desired output that you know, okay, 0, 1, means 0, okay. And then green functions, actually where G, capital G is called the green function. So you can have Gx1, T1, Gx1, T2, Gx1, Tn, then Gx2, T1, Gx2, T2. I mean, these are the way, because it is a matrix that you have to compute it. Next, you have to use this G of X minus T1, or you have this EXP of X minus T. There's the Euclidean norm. You have to compute it. Next, the D is given to you. So it is, that is a D is given to you. That is a 0, 1, 0, 1. Then you have W is already given, W1, W2 and B. Now where you have to compute this, G trans, G pseudo inverse D, then GT, G, the pseudo inverse, actually it is in like this, G transpose G, then inverse into G transpose D. Next, what you have to do, you have to compute inputs. We are going to apply this and same things into a generalized way of these things, x1, x2, then phi1, phi2, w1, w2, then b is a bias. Now the final output relation to the network will be, that is, I already told you, yx is equal to, j is equal to 1, 2 in wjk into phi jx. So instead of writing, you can write I is equal to 1, 2, 2, because as you are having these two neurons. Okay, so now w, that is to be computed, in this case, then g of x minus ti, okay, or plus b. Then if y is greater than 0, then it is 1. This is the same process. Okay, so it is an exp of x minus ti square. This is the same process. Okay, that is an if y the plus 1. Okay, then if his y is greater than 0, then class 1, otherwise it is in class 2. So main things is, so it is very simple thing, so you I mean, no need to worry about it. So it is very fast in computation process. So only that is, this thing is that you have to compute these concepts. Okay, that is a hidden key. For phi 1 you have to compute, then phi 2, then these weights. Okay, so that is all about your neural network function networks. So people are using is RVFN due to its advantage of, that is, it can solve this function approximations problem, and it is a universal approximation and gives faster running speed. Okay, and next question is, when do you stop it? Okay, when do you stop the algorithm? So now, if the training of RBF model is terminated, once the calculated error, if the calculated error reached the desired values, suppose you have chosen the calculated error is, that is a 0.001. I mean, this is a mean square error. Okay, so your objective is that to find this the mean square error will be minimum over the entire training data sets. And also it may, or if you want to just run the iteration of 500, which is, if it is fine, there's 500, let's say 500, then it is completed, then also you can wait. So this is the things that RBF, so this is a very good way of representing, okay. This W, one is W, you have to compute. Okay. Next is your sigma. This is your phi. So there's a different way of representation that is there. Any questions, so you can ask me. Okay. If you have any doubts regarding this thing. Because you have to implement, so it is not possible in the lab that you have to implement each and every technique. So parallelly you can implement it because time is less, so I cannot give it to you this all these techniques in the lab, because whatever important things like this, if you implement NN, we solve this XOR gate and AND gate in the next lab. We can also solve it. So now radial basis function is very popular and sometimes in different applications. So if you know the way of the basic things, okay, if this concept is clear to you, okay, means what exactly it is portraying, is why it is taking less time. Okay, so it is very parametric form. In the parametric form we can easily compute it. There's a mu and sigma, so easily it is possible to compute. So no need to run this entire process for the MLP that it need to follow. So that is the way. So here also there is a difference between this MLP and RBFN is there. So there is one thing is left, so that is called this probabilistic neural network, that is called the PNN. So tomorrow morning from 8 to 9, so I'll discuss the probabilistic neural network. Okay, then somehow it will be stopped, this neural network. Then next week I'll start this is a decision tree. First I'll complete decision tree, that is very important classifier. Okay, decision tree. Then what is left, that is a k means clustering is left, so it will take a couple of lectures to complete this clustering, and then I'll come back to the deep neural network. So now again I'll come back the autoencoder concepts. Okay, and this is a like this recurrent neural network. Okay, it's time permits, and I'll discuss the reinforcement learning here, because probably third week of March that the time limit. So I'll try to complete the maximum courses so that you can start implementing or start thinking your research in these directions. Okay. I think you don't have any questions. Okay, so we'll meet tomorrow. 8 to 9, all are free, na? Tomorrow.
Okay, sir.
Tomorrow, 8 to 9, and also next class also. Next week also I'll take one extra class from the same time, 8 to 9. Thank you.